Well, thank you, everybody, for joining us today for a conversation on Trump, populism, nationalism, and the state of our politics today. Before I introduce our speaker and delve into the subject, I just want to introduce the series that this is part of. This is part of a new discussion series we've inaugurated called Opening Arguments, Conversations on American Constitutionalism. And the idea is to bring people together to discuss constitutionalism in its broadest sense, not the narrow legalism of the courts and lawyers, I mean, there's some of that, but also just constitutionalism in the broader sense of who we are and how we govern ourselves. We've already had a law professor, Josh Blackman, come in. We're very happy to have Matt today. The next few speakers will be on April 5th, Hadley Arkus on natural law and the Constitution, and then on May 5th, Rabbi Amer Soloveitchik on religion and the state. And in June, on June 21st, Professor John Inazu on his wonderful book, Confident Pluralism. So I hope you'll join us for that. We'll be sending out announcements as they're finalized. But all of this is, as we see it, in line with the Hoover Institution's original and ongoing mission, as defined by Herbert Hoover himself in his 1959 statement to the Board of Trustees, where he stressed that this institution supports the Constitution of the United States, its Bill of Rights, and its method of representative government. Ours is a system where the federal government should undertake no governmental, social, or economic action except where local government or the people cannot undertake it for themselves. And so, again, we're very happy today to have Matt Continetti from the Washington Free Beacon here to discuss his ongoing analysis and investigation into the state of our politics. You know Matt as the co-founder and editor-in-chief of the Washington Free Beacon, one of the liveliest sources of news and commentary today.
Why are they laughing?
It's a lively
I'm asked the same question.
It's fun.
It is fun.
Before founding the Free Beacon, he was a writer and then opinion editor of the Weekly Standard, and he's authored two books. First, in 2006, The K Street Gang, The Rise and Fall of the Republican Machine, and then in 2009, The Persecution of Sarah Palin, How Elite Media Tried to Bring Down a Rising Star. Now, in hindsight, the themes that Matt explored for the decade preceding the last election seem to me deeply connected to our present moment. After a decade writing on political populism, juxtaposed with the political, cultural, and bureaucratic elite, Matt is uniquely well positioned to think about Trump, his supporters, and his enemies, which is why Matt's weekly column every Friday is reliably one of the best things you'll read every week. So Matt, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Let's start with a very open question. How should we think about populism and nationalism?
I think we should think about it in terms of a recurring tendency in American life, and that there's always a case that's made that Trump, President Trump's unique, that he's one of a kind, that the biggest danger we have is of normalizing him. And while he personally is someone who is, suffice it to say, one of a kind, I think the forces in our political and cultural and social life and our economic life are perennial. And there have been previous populist moments in American life before, and there probably will be again. So I think the first thing to think about is that what's happening today in Washington is not that unusual. Though there is something that is novel, and it's less about Trump and his supporters than it is about what they're what they think they're fighting. And that is kind of two phenomena. One is the creation of what Charles Murray calls the bubble, a self-contained cognitive elite of remarkably affluent, remarkably well-credentialed people who tend to cluster around the megalopolis in the east and Silicon Valley and Los Angeles, California, and whose view of the world and of themselves and of history and of the way politics should work, government should work, the aims of the presidency, political, social life, are quite fixed. And this is, I think, a pretty new development, as Murray has said, because the things that have created this bubble are pretty novel in terms of assortative mating, people who go with college degrees or higher, only marrying those with similar educational backgrounds, for example. And then, of course, just the remarkable surge in our national wealth and the growing inequality in America today. So that's interesting. That's novel. The other thing is this group of people in Washington tends to occupy positions of great influence in the bureaucracy or in the courts. And as a lapsed lawyer, you know this. And through these mechanisms, wield great power over our lives. However, that power is not necessarily constitutional. Mm-hmm. And indeed, it's separated from the idea of democratic control. And I think this is what is somewhat unique about the present moment. In the last populist upsurge, you could say, which was during Ross Perot and Pat Buchanan's ascendancy, there was a rebellion against kind of the global trade system and attempts to create that system. Here we have a rebellion that's really against almost everything that comes out of Washington, D.C., whether it's from the Supreme Court, whether it's from the agencies, mm-hmm. whether it's from kind of the cultural discourse mm-hmm. that's promulgated here, what you're supposed to say, what you're not allowed to say, what you're supposed to think, what you're not allowed to think. It's greater in magnitude than I think, certainly, than the last one, and possibly greater than many earlier occurrences.
You know, I wasn't going to delve too far into this, but you mentioned Murray and his, you know, coming apart and his idea on the bubble. Then the next book he wrote was We the People, which was an investigation of the decline of constitutional checks and balances. And it always struck me as he was talking about two symptoms of the same forces, right? That the same forces that were drawing us apart and then establishing this elite were the same ones that were carrying out this sort of supra-constitutional form of government.
You know, who is sovereign? And I think over the last 4 years, you could make the case that it wasn't necessarily the voting public.
Yeah. Now, you said this is nothing new. It's a recurring cycle. And the cycle picks up in the writings of writers that you've thought a lot about over time, going back at least, you know, into the 20th century, Burnham, Buckley, Irving Kristol, and others. And you wrote two magazine articles a couple of years ago about James Burnham, the National Review co-founder. You wrote one for the Weekly Standard called The Managers versus the Managed on Burnham's view of our ruling class, especially in the bureaucratic elite. And then the other was a book review of Burnham's probably his last book, I guess, Suicide of the West, right, which was Burnham's analysis of Western cultural decline. What drew you to Burnham? And tell us a little bit about Burnham and how we should think about him today.
Well, James Burnham is somebody that everybody in Washington should know. He's a fascinating character. And there's one biography of him by a man named Daniel Kelly. Mm-hmm. But William F. Buckley said that James Burnham was the most important intellectual influence on National Review. So by that endorsement alone, he's worthy of study and investigation, despite being almost universally forgotten today. Burnham, just to go through the biography very quickly, he was born in 1905. He went to Princeton and to Oxford. He had a PhD in aesthetics. That was his specialization in philosophy. He taught at NYU, where he met Sidney Hook, the great Marxist theoretician at the time, later associated with the Hoover Institute, I believe, when he became an anti-communist philosopher and liberal. And Burnham became a Trotskyite and got into a huge fight with Trotsky in the 1930s over whether the Soviet Union was a worker state. And this fight, which is collected in a book that I happen to own, is just fascinating. And Trotsky expelled James Burnham from the Trotsky movement because of his heresies.
I guess Trotsky gets to decide such things.
Right. Yeah. If you're Trotsky, that's one of the
benefits. Right, yeah.
So Burnham began, from that moment on, moving to the right. And he was associated with the little magazines like Partisan Review, and really just a fascinating literary journalist, really, a New York intellectual. But he became more and more anti-communist as his life went on, and really he separated from the left at the time of the McCarthy hearings, and was basically expelled again from another circle, in this case the New York intellectual circle of anti-Stalinist liberals, for being too soft on McCarthy. And so there he found himself with National Review. Mm-hmm. There are two key books in James Burnham's thought, in my view. He wrote several, but the two most important ones are a book called The Machiavellians and a book called The Managerial Revolution.
And the first one was written while he was still a Marxist, right? And then, am I right?
Yeah, he was still basically a Marxist when he wrote both. I mean, it was during that time of transition, 41, 43. And both were reviewed excellently by George Orwell. So you kind of get a picture of the circles in which Burnham was operating in. And if you go to the collected works of Orwell, even the journalism collection, the four-volume one that I think is still accessible, you can see Orwell review Burnham negatively, but respectfully. And so what? So what's the argument? So in the argument in the Machiavellians is that all politics is a facade for the disputations between elites. Mm-hmm. That we call it democracy, but in fact, democracy is a myth and masks rule by a select class of people. And this is just always the case. And when I first read Burnham in this book in 2013, and you come across this passage where he makes this argument, it's really like kind of a Saul of Tarsus moment. Mm-hmm. You know, you're kind of like, whoa, how can he say that? And the other argument he makes in The Managerial Revolution is that the whole order of the world economy, the world society is changing. He makes this argument in 1941, and so what he's saying is that really we're moving from a position of laissez-faire and a liberal democracy into a position of basically more or less totalitarian states, and Soviet Union, Nazi Germany, and then he added another one, FDR's New Deal. And this was a radical argument at the time. But he said what linked them all was the idea that of rule through a bureaucracy. That the bureaucracies and the managers of the bureaucracies in all three of these societies would actually have final determination of the distribution of wealth. Who got what? Who could say what? Mm-hmm. And so this is a radical thesis, which Orwell disagreed with, even though he took a lot of Burnham's ideas when he wrote 1984. And of course, in that tripartite division of the world in 1984, that's straight out of James Burnham. Mm-hmm. So these were the foundational ideas of Burnham's thought. And they came to influence National Review, I think, to some degree. Burnham's conclusion was, in the Machiavellians, that if you wanted to preserve freedom, what you had to aim for was what it was called juridical defense, and it came from he was writing about an earlier Italian thinker named Gaetano Mosca. And the idea of juridical defense was you just needed to create veto points to stop the bureaucracy. And what he's really describing is checks and balances. It's not too far from a Madisonian view, that if you want to preserve freedom, you have to create different interests, and they need to be able to check and balance one another.
Yeah.
So I think that led him to a kind of constitutionalism that he discussed in later works, as well as an anti-communism. So the Burnham, I think, is especially important to the present moment. Mm-hmm. When you see, like I was saying, agencies and bureaucrats exhibit total control over the events of the day. I mean, I give two examples of this. One is, after the 2014 election, despite saying 11 times that he lacked the constitutional authority to extend his DACA program.
The immigration
amnesty for the children. It was originally in 2012 for the children who were brought here illegally. He said 11 times during the 2014 election cycle that he could not extend it to the parents of those children. after losing that cycle in 2014, and despite saying this 11 times, what did Barack Obama do? He attempted to extend it to the parents. So the role, the role of the voters in this decision was negligible. Yeah. The other example I give was last year in the course of our election campaign, we woke up one Saturday morning to the news in the New York Times that the Department of Education had decided that every single bathroom in our nation's public schools would be gender neutral. Yeah. Who made that decision? Yeah. Obama didn't campaign on it. He didn't give a speech announcing it. It was just made.
Now, Obama, you and I have discussed this before, Obama said, believed or at least said that what he was doing, even if it wasn't through Congress, was in the name of the people, right? He was, what was the quote again, that he
Well, after the 2014 election, and this is when I knew there would be trouble, is he said, yeah, sure, I heard from the people who voted, but I heard from all the people who didn't vote, too.
Right. So he
well, that's not how our system is meant to work.
Right.
Now, our system is a reflection of the people who vote.
Now, to bring it back to Burnham, though, the elites, the class that Burnham was identifying right about at the time, did they see, do you think they saw themselves as a democratic elite, right? Or they just saw themselves as an elite that were going to pull the people one way or the other, regardless of what they, the people thought?
It's hard to say.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that the elites I'm describing today view themselves as democratic.
Yeah.
What you have to look at is not what they say, but what they do. This is an approach I also take with President Trump.
Yeah.
He says a lot of things. I tend to focus on what he actually does.
Yeah. So now the interesting thing about Burnham in our time is that Burnham began writing about bureaucracy, like you said, and then he moves on to Congress, the American tradition. He's thinking about this. But then he ends his writing career with Suicide of the West, you know, columns about the struggle for the world, which I think is the name of the Kelly biography, right? And so Burnham started from an internationalist Marxist vision, brought it to, you know, the local level of the United States, but then again in the end mapped it onto a broader worldwide struggle, which is in a way the way that some people are characterizing our current moment, right? Whether it's comparing what's happening here to Brexit, right, or it's Steve Bannon's thoughts on Western decline beyond just the United States. I mean, Burnham saw this as a very big picture, right, and all of it tied together. Is that how we should think about the debates over populism?
Yeah, and you know, I wish we had Burnham today, someone yeah. like Burnham was had a stroke in the early 1980s, which really ended his writing life.
Would Burnham endorse Bannon's approach to Bannon's worldview?
Burnham had very complicated views on populism.
Yeah.
There's an essay he wrote in the early 1970s for National Review where he was trying to analyze the rise of George Wallace in American life. And National Review opposed George Wallace. Buckley called Wallace and other people welfare populists. And what Burnham was saying in his essays were, you know, he's obviously not conservative, George Wallace, but he may represent a future form of politics, a post liberal politics.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if he were present today, he would see another post-liberal form of politics emerging.
Yeah.
He knew, you know, Burnham is a fascinating character. Despite these kind of radical ideas he had about the world and about the necessity to confront communism ruled by, he also felt it was very important for conservatives to be moderate in practice,
right.
Certainly on the domestic front, in order to attract their own elite. He wanted to create an alternative elite to what he saw as the ruling liberal elite, which was basically consigning itself to communist rule. So in that sense, I think Burnham would be opposed to what Steve Bannon represents.
Yeah.
Burnham would see, and Buckley did see, the value of an elite. It just had to be a conservative one.
So now, changing gears and thinking about somebody else from the time, Irving Kristol. Right? He wrote about populism throughout his career, but the quote I like the most actually comes from his take on McCarthy, 1952. He writes a commentary, he says, there's one thing the American people know about Senator McCarthy. He, like them, is unequivocally anti-communist. About the spokesman for American liberalism, they feel no such thing, and with some justification, right? So from the very beginning, Kristol recognized that this form of populism that was fueling McCarthy was a reaction to elites as much as anything else, right?
Yeah, that essay, Civil Liberties, A Study in Confusion, mm-hmm. Was the most controversial thing that Irving Kristol ever wrote, and he wrote it when he was 32 years old, right, before he became a conservative. And it was controversial for the same reason that Burnham was controversial in those circles. He had the temerity to say that Joseph McCarthy should be taken seriously.
Yeah.
Well, I think we see some parallels today, actually, yeah, for the people who say that Donald Trump should be taken seriously are often met with...
Not literally, but seriously.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
That was what Kristol was saying about McCarthy.
Right.
Don't take him literally, take him seriously.
Right.
So what is he saying in this piece? He goes through the piece in a various ways that liberal professors have condemned McCarthy, mainly Henry Steele Commager, the famous Harvard historian. And he finds them wanting. He finds them totally evasive. And so that comes to that line where he says, look, at least we know that McCarthy is anti-communist. With these guys, the way that they're writing, you don't really have that assurance.
Yeah.
I guess it was that essay in particular was a sense of the distance between American intellectuals and the American public, which is something that Kristol also revisited in American Historians and the Democratic Idea, another mm-hmm. famous essay of his. By 1972, 74, he wrote a piece called The New Populism, Not to Worry,
right,
which was really, again, Irving Kristol saying that the intellectuals have it all wrong, the elites have it all wrong. And that the populism you saw in kind of the tax revolt and the rise of the new right, in some of the beginnings of the religious conservative movement, and certainly in the forms of popular anti-busing laws in the 1970s, should be taken very seriously as legitimate grievances. I think that's where he most speaks to the present moment in that essay.
Now, Kristol starts off, though, or he doesn't start off, but most famously starts the public interest, right? A term that's drawn from not just legal New Deal era statutes, you know, giving agencies broad power to regulate in the public interest, right? The public interest was sort of, in a way, almost a technocratic term,
yeah,
right? And the idea of the magazine was that policy could be judged objectively, good or bad, and studied, you know, separate from whether it was popular or not, right? So, in a way, the public interest begins as a very technocratic endeavor and quickly shifts over into this part of Kristol's career that we're talking about now, where he's reacting in favor of populism. Was that a shift, or is this just two separate parts of Kristol's thinking?
Well, I think there's a difference between empiricism and technocracy.
Yeah.
Empiricism is a method of knowledge. It's how you learn. You're going to look at the facts and what the studies tell you. Technocracy is a matter of decision making.
Well, let me put it this way then. The public interest was an affirmative endeavor, right? It wasn't there to destroy so much as to help guide public policy in a very technocratic moment.
Right.
Right.
But he found that the elites are wrong.
Yeah.
He found that the elites are wrong. He had a column in the Wall Street Journal called Whatever Happened to Common Sense. Yeah. Or he said, take two issues, education and crime. These are two issues that he visits in the populism essay, too.
Yeah.
That what the elite think about these two issues is completely off the mark. In terms of education, it was what? More inputs will lead to better outputs. And that's been proven wrong for 40, well, no, the Coleman Commission was 65, right?
Yeah.
51 years, we've known that's not the case. Yet we do it, we persist. Yeah. Crime at the time was the therapeutic approach. What's all crime is the consequence of environmental degradation. Give people money, better health care, better schools, they won't commit crimes. That was the basis to some degree of great society programs, urban renewal. It failed. So there was always a sense that, you know what, the truth is empiricism can lead to a form of populism. If you look at the data, it may actually show that, no, what most people think is completely incorrect.
Yeah.
And I actually think that's somewhat true if you look at the arguments over, say, the language we use in the war on terror. Mm-hmm. There's a real kind of antipathy and anger that is provoked when people refuse to connect the religious ideology of Islamism to the acts that are perpetrated most recently is today. What do we know every time something one of these attacks occurs? It was every single anchor will say, we're still waiting for the motive. Yeah. What was the motive? Right. And anyone with common sense knows what the motive was.
Right. And that was the core of the article you mentioned, the new populism, not to worry, right? He's identifying crime and race in other areas.
Now, I should say in that essay, too, and it's important to recognize, he says that populism was not something that the founders appreciated, nor did Irving Kristol.
Right.
And he concludes the essay by saying, it's for this reason, that the wrongheadedness of the elite, that I'm willing to give the populists a chance.
Yeah.
And he was probably right to do so, because those forces he saw active in public life eventually gave Ronald Reagan the presidency.
Yeah, I jotted down, because I knew we were going to talk about this, I jotted down the quote. This is from that essay. He says, the important thing to emphasize is that this new populism is no kind of blind rebellion against good constitutional government. It's rather an effort to bring our governing elites to their senses. That's why so many people, and I include myself among them, Crystal saying, would ordinarily worry about a populist upsurge, but find themselves so sympathetic to this new populism.
Right.
That sounds a lot like our, you know, something about.
You know, in an earlier essay, he reviews his friend Marvin Myers was a historian and wrote a book called The Jacksonian Persuasion. This is in the, it may actually be the late 50s, if not the 60s. So this book, The Jacksonian Persuasion, comes out, and Irving Kristol reviews it. And the review is in the collection that's still in print, the Neoconservative Persuasion. And he quotes from Myers in that review, and he says, Myers says, the thing about Jacksonianism is, even if it's not necessarily effective as a governing strategy, it still forces the country to ask itself, what is its purpose? Mm-hmm. And I reread that review recently, and it hit me as very relevant for today. I think we can see it in headlines. With the eruption that happened may not be very effective as a governing strategy, but it is forcing a conversation about what is America, who is in charge. Is there a difference between citizens of this country and people who want to get into this country? That persuasion, the Jacksonian persuasion, is very much alive.
Okay, so I hate to try to boil Irving Kristol down to one sentence. It's impossible.
It's hard.
But, I mean, if there's one takeaway that people today, thinking about our modern situation, there's one thing that they should take from Kristol's work, or one place that they should begin in reading, and what would you suggest?
In terms of what's happening in American politics today?
Yeah.
I think that essay on populism is important. Yeah. But, you know, the essay that I always return to is Christianity, Judaism, and Socialism, mm-hmm. Which was basically the distillation of comments he made during a colloquy with Michael Novak and other theologians, and Novak, of course, recently passed away, where basically Irving Kristol's critique of the world comes across as essentially a religious one, and we're dealing with all of this as a result of the collapse in faith.
That's interesting. I mean, before we get on to the next 20th century thinker, Irving Kristol, who wrote about so much, ultimately comes down to sort of a crisis of faith. Burnham, I don't know whether he was religious or not, but
not at all.
But
he kept that part of his Marxism.
Right, but his book, The Suicide of the West, was in some sense reflection on a global, I don't want to say crisis of spiritualism, but it was a loss of that. And even somebody like Whitaker Chambers, right, another famous anti-communist. At the end of the day, his critique of what was happening in the world boiled down to a crisis of faith and conscience, as much as anything else, right? All three very serious and not, you think of as classically religious thinkers. They all saw so much of this boiling down to a crisis of spirit and character.
Burnham would put it as the willingness to uphold myths.
Yeah. Well, so let's think about one person who was a very explicitly faithful and religious person, William F. Buckley, right? When we think about Buckley and populism, there's the famous line about the phone book. But before we get to that, the third quote I jotted down before today, it's actually from his book, Up from Liberalism, from 1959. and he's criticizing liberals for their commitment to democracy. And he says, the commitment by the liberals has proved obsessive, even fetishistic. Even though democracy is a mere procedure, all the hopes of an epic are vested in it. And indeed, democracy becomes epistemology. Democracy will render reliable political truths just as surely as the marketplace sets negotiable economic values. The democracy of universal suffrage is not a bad form of government. It's simply not necessarily nor inevitably a good form of government. Democracy must be justified by its works, not by doctrinaire affirmations of its intrinsic goodness. So that's where he starts in 1959, but not long afterwards he's talking about democracy in very, very positive terms as a reaction against the elites, right? And this is the famous phone book line.
I'd rather be ruled by the first 400 names in the
Boston
phone book than by the faculty of Harvard University.
Right. So how did Buckley wind up there?
William Buckley was a man of many contradictions.
Right.
He was not this type of thinker, certainly not the systematic thinker that Burnham was, and I'm not even sure the type of thinker that Crystal was.
Yeah. He's Whitman-esque, he contains multitudes.
Well, he was more of a popularizer and an activist.
Yeah.
To our enduring credit.
Mm-hmm.
What's happening? I think always Buckley was an elitist.
Yeah.
I actually don't think he was a populist at all, despite that line.
Mm-hmm.
That line is, you know, the famous Buckley wit. He had, I think sometimes when the wit led him in one direction, he would go in that direction, even if maybe it wasn't consistent with his thought or something. He was like a good comic. He was willing to go for the punchline.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, it speaks to this problem with the elite, right? That Crystal identified and Burnham identified at a much higher level. But that, elites disagree. So you say, oh, well, what is the consensus on weight loss, right? We have a huge argument about how to lose weight. Moreover, elites are wrong when they're typically wrong when they agree uniformly.
Yeah.
And there too, like the science writer Gary Tobes would say, on weight loss, it's exactly, people thought, oh, don't eat red meat, eat carbs. Then we discover 50 years later, no, eat red meat, don't eat carbs.
Right.
You know what, as I like to remind people, basically everyone in a position of authority thought that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction.
Mm-hmm.
Oops. No one saw the financial crisis coming, not even Paul Krugman. So that's what Buckley is saying there.
Yeah.
In terms of his practice in politics, I think, like if we just refer back to that comment he made about George Wallace, he was very suspicious of democracy.
Yeah.
Sometimes wrongly so, when he opposed the Civil Rights Act and desegregation, but he always thought that democracy as a procedural thing,
yeah,
could lead to bad outcomes, and that you had to have, and he's right about this, you had to have some standard of right or wrong that was beyond democracy. This would be, you know, this would be a critique of anyone who says, well, the voters have spoken, so whoever the president is should have leeway. That, or you look at the tyranny that public polling has over our lives. But William F. Buckley would say, well, that just because a majority is for something doesn't mean that it's right. That's what he's saying in that quote.
So one of Buckley's most famous moments is the Panama Canal debate, a televised debate with Reagan. And Buckley finds himself juxtaposed not just with Reagan, but if I remember correctly, Pat Buchanan, right? Buchanan was on Reagan's side of that debate.
Yeah.
So let's talk about Buchanan. Buchanan is the most recent populist, I guess, along with Perot, leading up to the modern moment. How much of the current Trump moment is a reflection of the themes that Buchanan was bringing to the table?
90%.
Really? He's like almost exclusively Buchananite?
Well, if you think at what Buchanan's main issues were and have been, they were trade, mm-hmm. they were immigration, and they were war, American empire.
Mm-hmm.
And Donald Trump campaigned as an opponent of all three of those things. So I think he is heavily Buchananite, and which is ironic since the last time Donald Trump, well, not the last time, the first official time Donald Trump flirted with running for the presidency was in 2000, when he found himself opposing Pat Buchanan for the nomination of the Reform Party, and hated Pat Buchanan and all of the vitriol and insults that we've become accustomed to from President Trump were leveled at Pat Buchanan's. Despite actually, especially on the trade issue, even at that time, basically agreeing 100%.
And I guess, having just mentioned Buckley, I should point out that I think Buckley wrote an essay on Trump's campaign at the time. He wrote it for Cigar Aficionado, and it was called Here Come the Demagogues.
Yeah.
Right, so I guess Buckley was a critique
Buckley
of Trump.
Buckley was consistent in his anti-populism. Yeah.
But Trump, you said he was disagreeing with Buchanan in 2000 or whenever, and then so he migrates then to where he is today.
Yes, not on trade, and I don't even think on war. You know, the famous piece of evidence that Trump was for the Iraq War is this Howard Stern interview, where it's clear if you listen to him, Howard Stern asks Donald Trump, "Well, are you for the Iraq War?" And Trump goes, "Yeah, I guess so." I mean, it's just clear he hadn't given it much thought and wasn't very enthusiastic.
He might not have known there was a war.
Very clearly. He watches the shows.
That's true. So
he saw it on the shows. Immigration, I think he picked up a little. Well, I think we know he really picked it up by reading Ann Coulter's book in 2013, Adios America. 2015.
Okay.
And saying, this is it. This has power. So he moved to this Buchananite position and, of course, embraced it wholeheartedly when he unveiled his campaign slogan and, indeed, the slogan of his administration, America First.
Now, earlier you said that James Burnham's view of politics was that it was a contest between elites, right? Everything else is just sort of false, and it really is at root a contest between elites.
Yeah.
I mean, the cynic would say that President Trump became president by adopting populist rhetoric, themes that he read from Ann Coulter, themes that he saw from Buchanan. But at the end of the day, he is a New York, he's a New York billionaire.
Yeah.
Is it unfair to wonder if maybe this is still a war between elites, Trump's elite and the liberal elite, or is
no,
Trump
no.
a genuine?
Burnham would say that's exactly what's happening.
Yeah.
I mean, Donald Trump, his chief advisor is Goldman Sachs alumnus, Steve Bannon, who got rich off of Seinfeld royalties, of all things.
Let's talk about Bannon for a second, though. I mean, Bannon, you read the talk that he gave to that Vatican audience and other things he's written, and it does, you don't have to squint to see a lot of echoes of Burnham and these other thinkers we've been talking about going far, far back. Do you get the sense that Bannon is deeply read in those, that he's drawing explicitly, or is he just intuiting the same themes?
He's a very widely read man.
Interesting.
I don't know how familiar he is with Burnham or Irving Kristol, but just from every other report we have, he's read widely and deeply.
Yeah. Well, we have audience microphones if people want to ask questions of Matt, and they'll come around now. But before we turn to those, and Anya, you can take the microphone. There's a question right in back. Let's just try to sum this up very briefly. I mean, having thought about Burnham, Kristol, Buckley, Buchanan, and Bannon, a lot of Bs, what's your general sense as you're trying to think through all of this? I mean, what's your organizing principle as you grapple through all this? Not to throw a pretty big question at you as we're handing out microphones.
The elites are in a battle for domination of the country. And one group of them has basically adopted the position of democracy and the traditions of the founding. And the other has rejected those in favor of basically a transnational, for lack of a better word, globalist vision.
Ironically, the party that's called Democrats is the party that's rejected democracy.
Well, the party of Andrew Jackson.
Yeah.
I think one of the most important moments in understanding the present moment is the rejection of Jackson from the $20 bill by the Obama administration.
Right.
And a year and a half later, Donald Trump's visit to the Hermitage.
Right.
Well, so all of a sudden, the Jacksonian tradition has moved, and it happened over many years, but this is clear that the break is decisive. It moved from the Democratic Party to the Republican one. And one of the reasons we're having fights like we're having on Capitol Hill right now is that the leadership of the Republican Party has not recognized that shift.
Right.
And is, and perhaps rightly so, deeply uncomfortable with it.
Yeah, and it's interesting, right, that while the Obama White House was rejecting Jackson on the $20 bill, their longest lasting legacy might be a Broadway musical on Alexander Hamilton. Right. So, all right, we have a question in the back.
What is an elite and who are
they? Yeah, well, the perennial question of people who study them. But you would say that they are, you know, the 1% and probably the top 5%. The people who have the degrees, the people who hold offices, the people who write for our newspapers, who profess in our universities, the people who make decisions and form opinions and have discussions like we're having at the Hoover Institute.
Is that the same thing as Irving Kristol's new class?
Very similar.
Okay.
No, but of course, the new class that Irving Kristol described, which is basically the managerial class,
right,
which is this technocratic class and kind of a class that has a negative attitude toward the ideas of the American founding, that's one part of the elite. And I think you're right to point out that the elite has different components. You know, for every Barack Obama, there's a Paul Ryan.
Yeah.
So this elite isn't, the American elite is divided. But I think, yeah, it's the, you know, the top people.
On Bannon, when he said that he wanted to abolish the administrative state, attack, what do you think he meant by that? And to what extent do you think Congress recognizes that as a problem?
Well, I don't think Congress recognizes that the administrative state's a problem at all. And it's, I think, one of, so what is the administrative state? I think the administrative state is John Marini's description of James Burnham's managerial rule. That's how I see it. The administrative state is the bureaucracies and the judiciary and basically the whole corpus of administrative law. And it's not constitutional because it doesn't make room for the separation of powers.
Mm-hmm.
It combines the legislative function, the executive function, and the judicial function, all in one, which is exactly what the founders were against. So when Bannon says he wants to tear down the administrative state, I think he's actually operating within a longstanding conservative tradition. The problem is that this form of government is now so embedded that Congress, in my view, is nothing more than an oversight committee.
Mm-hmm.
Congress doesn't pass laws anymore. It passes directives to the administrative state that then write the laws without any oversight.
Right. They've been like they've become the ombudsman for the administrative state.
The Congress has.
Yeah.
And
right.
So whenever we say, oh, Congress has a big day on Capitol Hill today, right, what is it? Oh, it's a hearing. That's right. The big days on Capitol Hills when they have hearings and they emote before the cameras in front of the executive officials who are literally making all of the decisions.
Yeah.
But they don't have the type of legislative authority that they did in any constitutionalist conception of our government.
Yeah, I was at a hearing a couple of days ago on one of these agencies, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and I was really struck the Democratic members of the committee who were there to criticize the witnesses who were criticizing the agency, they were complaining that the Democrats in the committee were arguing that the CFPB was the true representatives of the people, defending...
Just like Obama after the 2014 election.
Yeah, exactly. It was really interesting.
The people aren't the voters. The people are the constituency that you have in your head.
Yeah, and the members of Congress were arguing that it was okay to take power away from Congress and give it to this agency,
right,
because the agency was the better representatives of the people than Congress is. And at the same time, they were the same members of Congress were taking credit for having passed the law to create the agency in the first place, and said they did it in response to the political outcry. So they had a populist moment to pass a law to create an agency to take power away from Congress. It was really surreal.
It's immune from public oversight,
yeah,
really.
So it was a fun hearing, though. It was an exciting day on Capitol Hill. David Azrat?
One new term that I'd never heard before that I've started hearing is the deep state.
Right.
My initial inclination was to dismiss it as a conspiracy theory,
right?
But you look at some of what's going on right now. I don't think the administrative state can perhaps properly account for everything we're seeing in terms of the level of opposition to Trump from within his own administration. Do you have any thoughts on that word, where it comes from, what it means? Is it legitimate?
Well, deep state's a term that was used to describe the Turkish and Egyptian security apparatus in the 80s, and then has since, through the internet, like so many ideas these days, has now become part of our daily political discourse. I tend to view it as a part of this administrative state or this managerial state, because the people who are leaking against the administration today are associated with the national security agencies that are part of this bureaucracy that has grown up over time. And it's very worrisome, because this is the first time we're seeing that this apparatus can be used to actually target an individual, even though we might have our individual problems with that individual for independent reasons. It's a little bit odd that all of a sudden his identity would be unmasked.
Now, there's a thing called, I don't know if they call themselves or it's been called, the resistance. This idea that within the agency,
it's all starting to sound like a Star Wars movie. You know, they get the deep state, the resistance. The resistance and the deep state are on the same side, which should make people's eyebrows raise a little bit, I think. This is one of my big problems with the people inside the bubble, is they have such a high conception of themselves. You know, it's like, we're not opposed to Donald Trump. We're part of the resistance. You know, like they're Maquis fighters or something. It's just self-congratulatory.
Before we get to the next question, how do you think this will play out as a political observer? You have self-styled resistance movements and agencies pushing back against Trump's appointed leaders in these agencies. You have the people inside the intelligence community that are leaking information. In the midst of a major populist moment, at least in the Republican Party, how does this, what's the end game?
It's not going to end well.
Yeah. For who?
I don't think for anybody.
Okay.
No, what happened to Elaine Chao's Twitter, the Secretary of Transportation, a wife of the Senate Majority Leader? One of her aides hijacked her Twitter account yesterday and started talking about impeaching the president.
Really?
Yeah. It was on very briefly. Wow. It was like, did you see the thing that happened with the McDonald's Twitter account last week? There's all of a sudden, Twitter's an amazing place, as our president knows. All of a sudden, the McDonald's corporate account was tweeting at Donald Trump saying, "You are a sorry excuse for a president and you have small hands." And then, and so people on Twitter were like, "Oh my God, this is unbelievable." Finally, it was taken down, and McDonald's issued a statement saying that our account was compromised.
It was actually a very subtle ad for the new Big Mac Jr.
Yeah, right. Well, I know. McDonald's, there are more readers of the McDonald's corporate account in those 5 minutes than there had been in years.
Yeah.
No, it's very revealing of the way that this bureaucracy thinks about its people, about the people that it oversees. Yeah. They elected him.
Yeah.
It was close. He didn't win a majority, but he won according to the rules. And yet the attitude toward that result in this city is nothing short of a psychotic breakdown.
Yeah. Well, on that cheery note, there's another question.
Lauren Thompson. Do you think Donald Trump is guided by any, what are his guiding principles?
Sure.
The reason I ask is, if he's a populist, why is he supporting this health care bill when it's only supported by 40% of the population?
Right. Well, I think he's coming to regret supporting the health care bill. What are his guiding principles? Here's what I know. Donald Trump first came onto the scene in American life in the 1980s. Art of the Deal was published in 1987. That same year, 1987, remember, so we're gearing up for the 88 campaign. And in fact, the right at that point was split. We were not sure. Was HW? Is it going to be Jack Kemp? Was it going to be Pat Buchanan? Like, who is going to be the heir to Reagan, right? So Art of the Deal comes out in 87. That same year, Donald Trump buys an ad in the New York Times where he goes after Ronald Reagan, specifically on the issue of trade. And then also to a lesser degree about kind of we're not winning, and what we're spending other money, we're money on other countries, not our own. I think that's consistent. That you can see as a guiding. Does he understand it as a principle? I'm not sure. I'm not sure he thinks in terms of principles. He has instincts. And as he, I think he told Time magazine, his instincts tend to be right. So he has this instinct that that free trade or whatever it is, global trade is bad for the United States. So that means then that globalization is bad, and therefore American intervention in the world, or what we call American empire, or kind of American hegemony, primacy, is also bad because we're not focused here. He wants to be focused here. I think that is consistent throughout his political career, 30-year political career. On other things, I'm not sure he's given as much thought, and so he's much more flexible. It's also hard in dealing with Trump because he's approaching it from the point of view of his self-understanding as a negotiator, right? So everything, he never wants to tell you what he's going to end up doing. Everything is up for negotiation. He always leads with extreme positions because then everything he gets after that is a win in his mind. So it makes for difficult understanding. But I do think on the issue of trade, overseas entanglements, and then and immigration, it really has been a more recent thing. But the truth is, he has stuck to that. I think he understands how integral that is to his political profile now. On those things, he has been remarkably consistent. And of course, with the healthcare thing, he gave that famous post-election interview on 60 Minutes, which he loves, you know, where he said, nothing's going to change, right? We're going to have the bill. People on 26 years old, you're going to stay. Pre-existing conditions, you're going to stay. It's going to happen right after. And then he found himself, I think, convinced by Paul Ryan about certain aspects of the legislative calendar, about getting ready for other things down the line, that this was the bill, that we needed to get this bill. We'll see if they do.
Well, really quick, on the trade thing, you said that was a core commitment that he identified early in the 80s, even before he had a political career. Do you have any idea where that came from?
No. Well, I mean, if you think about the 80s, the big debate then was auto imports. Mm-hmm. And Reagan took us to the brink on auto imports with Japan, and I think Trump probably saw that. Well, why are these great American companies losing market share to the Japanese? And then once you had the China shock of the beginning of this century, then I think it became, the political audience for that argument became just incredibly widespread. Because this sentiment, I mean, again, he might not understand it things in terms of principles, but the sentiments and instincts he has are shared by a lot of people, even more people than voted for him or more people than admit that they voted for him.
Ryan, do you have the microphone?
Ryan Schinkel, my question has to do with, basically, is Trump a progressive in the sense of a belief in his own expertise? My family and friends in Michigan, who are many of them avid Trump supporters, they think, well, he's an outsider, so he has a new perspective, he knows what he's doing. Or if he's just raising hell to shake up the system to get people in the right minds, he at least knows whatever he's doing, he knows how to do it. Mm-hmm. So my question is, if one is, say, in this populist moment, skeptical of more technocratic methods, wants things to be local, federalism, deliberation and action is the way of politics, not of mathematical prescribed policies. My question would be, what are the hopes for that, given the kind of ethos, in the sense that I'm the deal maker, I've done deals before, I can do them again?
Yeah. I don't think he's a technocrat, because I think technocrat carries with the connotations of this cognitive elite and this kind of love of expertise and big data. You know, oh, the data, big data tells us this, you know, so we're going to do this, and it doesn't matter whether you disagree. I'm not sure I would call him a small-D Democrat either. I alone can fix it. That was his line from the convention. I'm going to do the deals. But he's found himself in this weird position where he says he understands himself as leading a movement, a popular movement, that is akin to the Jacksonian movement in the early 19th century. And so, that's the attitudes he's adopted for himself. Let's see how it plays out.
The moment that really cemented the New Deal as an institution was when wasn't FDR or Truman, it was when Eisenhower, the Republican, sort of accepted it.
Yeah, crucial decade.
Right, and with Trump, if Trump adopts the basic approach to governance that Obama did, right, very executive power heavy, pushing through the agencies when legislation fails, not even try that hard at legislation, is there a risk that President Trump could in a way cement the structural approach to governance that President Obama
that
had?
That risk exists, but I'm not sure we've seen it yet. The major executive order was the travel ban. That's been rejected by the courts. He has obeyed the rulings of the courts.
But I alone can fix it is a pretty strong statement.
It is. I mean, it's fitting for a man who thinks of himself in that world historical terms. But here again, you have to look at the actual activity. I mean, what's his big mess he finds himself in? One of the messes he finds himself in today is this health care bill. Well, that's a legislative process. He's trying to go through it. Mm-hmm. Now, he may find when it fails that he'll do more through the executives. We'll just have to see. And whether that, I mean, no president has been rejected more by the Supreme Court than Barack Obama.
Right.
President Obama was rejected by the Supreme Court yesterday. He's not in office. He's still in D.C. He's not in office. But he's rejected. So, you know, we'll see if Trump takes these actions. We haven't yet. He's only been president for 2 months.
I'm Dan Griswold with the Mercatus Center. I have the interesting job these days of defending free trade.
I know,
Our engagement in the global economy, which I always thought was a good conservative position. Ronald Reagan talked about it. It's free market and all that. And not to mention, I feel I'm standing up for the Walmart shopper to make sure they can get lower prices. Now I find I'm part of the bi-coastal globalist elite.
We all are in this room.
Yeah, my question
you have plenty of company.
To you, Matthew, is are people who support free trade, are we just condemned to always be against the populace? Is there a way to make that the populist cause? You've mentioned trade and as a common thread with Trump, going back to Buchanan. How do you see free trade? Is that going to be an inevitable just victim of this populist wave and a new, more populist Republican Party?
Well, I think it is for the foreseeable future. But the way to make it populist is the way to have a political spokesman for it. And it is true, even before Trump, there weren't many great spokesmen for free trade, or at least great enough spokesmen that they could forge an audience for what they were saying. It became kind of just like a dogma. It waxes and wanes. But pulling out of the TPP is no small thing, and I don't think there's any going back to that. So it's a question of what does trade look like under Trump? We don't know. My big fear is we might not even get a chance to see. He's becoming so, the swamp is pretty deep and pretty, you can get entangled in it pretty quickly. And so all these great trade deals that he says he's going to reveal to us or negotiate, I don't see where they're coming down. I mean, we'll see how far he gets with them.
Roman.
Thank you, Adam. Roman Bueller, my question is, what do you think the legacy is going to be of this kind of populist moment? We have, for the first time in, who knows, right, we have 33 states with Republican majorities, Republican majorities in Congress. Saw a poll today, 97% of the people hate Washington politics. There's this sense that things are broken here. And you have Steve Bannon who says, let's deconstruct the administrative state. And you have Paul Ryan that says, well, we got to get our Article I power back. And every House Republican votes for the Reins Act. And of course, it's stuck in the Senate. And then an effort I'm involved in, there are 1,000 state legislators out there that support a constitutional version of the Reins Act and think that the same way the states could force Congress to propose the Bill of Rights, they could force Congress to propose something called a Regulation Freedom Amendment. The question is this a moment when there might actually be some curbs on the administrative state? And do you think Trump might decide to take that opportunity and lead that effort as his long-term legacy?
I think he's already started. The regulations he's rolled back in his 2 months in office, I think, have contributed to the increasing business confidence. I think that the kind of the notes he sounded on agencies like the FDA, for example, are extremely positive in order to increase choice and efficiency. Whether the legacy will be anything approaching to Steve Bannon's ambition, I'm more pessimistic about. But I've just become a pessimist generally.
And last question.
William Worley, I'm wondering about about the relation between populism and the masses, the concept of the masses. For example, you had the populares who supported Julius Caesar and eventually brought down the Roman aristocracy. You had the French Revolution, the Russian Revolution, which the masses supported, the anti-establishment and the Bolsheviks eventually. But there's also the Reagan Democrats and the Rust Belt that elected Trump. So
a lot of the same
it seems
people.
Like this is a mass phenomenon. It depends on the leader, I guess. How do you evaluate that?
I think it also depends on the country. We might just be a different country than imperialist Russia or pre-revolutionary France or the late Roman Republic. We have different traditions. We have different expectations. It is worrisome at the type of polarization in our society, a social polarization. And the example I give here is the opioid crisis. This is devastating. Thousands and thousands of people are dropping dead in the streets. And yet, if you were to turn on your news, the cable news, even before really the past 8 months, read the major newspapers, this would not exist. The most pressing social crisis of our time would be what's happening in Ferguson or what happened in Baltimore. Mm-hmm. Not to say that those not a problem in our society, but it's a question of what are we recognizing. I think there is, in America today, what I worry about is this: the people inside the bubble, not even beginning to conceive of what life might be like for the populations that they don't normally think about. Trump was like a wake-up call, because, oh, he can't win, he can't win, he can't, oh, he just won. But what are they doing now? Oh, Russia. Now look, I could not begin to explain to you what is going on with that investigation or what it means or what happens. But I do know that the people, the out of work auto worker in Michigan did not vote for him because of Russia. It was because of a long-standing grievance that the political class is not recognizing or doing anything about the problems he sees in his daily life. And so if we just go back to our old habits of saying, oh, he's not a legitimate president because of Russia, then that social crisis is going to continue to fester, and I think has, with really really malign consequences for our country.
I have one last question then. The out-of-work auto worker that helped elect Trump, right? Trump said, I alone can fix it, meaning problems in general. What's it going to take to convince that segment of Trump supporters that he's worth reelecting in 4 years? And if he doesn't convince them of that, what do you think the next political...
The guy needs to have a job.
Yeah. And if Trump doesn't get them jobs, who do you think...
He'll be troubled.
Yeah.
Unless the Democrats don't learn any lessons and think that they run the same campaign that they ran against him in 2016 and that all the Republicans did, which is Donald Trump's a bad person.
Yeah.
Well, I think the American public recognizes that fact.
Yeah. Well,
but the truth is, there were enough people who said, well, I'm going to take a chance anyway to get him elected. It might not work 4 years from now. Yeah. Now, if the economy is in recession and we're in the middle of an unpopular war, yeah. But if not, I think they have a strong, a big challenge ahead of them,
yeah.
Democrats.
Well, as I said before, but I do want to repeat it, two of the best articles I've read in recent years are your two articles on James Burnham. One in the Weekly Standard, one in National Review. And so I encourage everybody to look these up. They're available on Google. And also, be sure to check out Matt's column every Friday morning, which is one of the best reads in town. Matt, thank you so much.
Thank you.